Hello everyone, in this video we will be solving again the previous year questions related to the graph theory. We have seen the first part of this video and this is the second part of that same series. Now in this video we will be starting with graph coloring. Let us read the question. The minimum number of colors required to color the vertices of a cycle with n nodes in such a way that no two adjacent nodes have the same color. Let me explain you the problem first of all. See, you can have a graph with a cycle. For example, this is a graph which is having a cycle, okay? And this is a graph which is having three vertices, vertex A, vertex B and vertex C. In the same way, we might be having a graph with four vertices, so which is again the vertex A, vertex B, vertex C and vertex D. Now this is a cycle with five vertices. Okay, so vertex A, B, C, D and E. Now if you look at these graphs, so you can see here for this graph the chromatic number of this graph is going to be 3, right? So chromatic number is 3 in this graph, and in this graph the chromatic number is 2, and in this graph the chromatic number is again 3. See, whenever you have a graph which is having a cycle of odd length, in that case the chromatic number is 3, and if you have a graph with a cycle of even length, in that case the chromatic number is 2. So chromatic number is what is the minimum number of colors required to color the vertices of a graph in such a way that no two adjacent vertices are having the same color. Okay, this is what chromatic number says. So if I color green to the vertex A, if I give a color blue to the vertex B, then I have to give a color blue to this vertex C. So A, B and C, as you can see, these three vertices are having different colors. In the same case, here I can give vertex A as this color, and I can give the same color to vertex C, and I can give a color to vertex B, and here I can give a color to vertex B. So you can see minimum number of two colors are required, therefore chromatic number is 2. And in this case, if I can give a blue color to this, I can give a blue color to this, and I can give a maroon color to this, again I can give a maroon color to this, and then I need one more color to color this last vertex E, right? So in case of a graph which is having even cycle, for even cycle graph the chromatic number is 2, for odd cycle graph the chromatic number is 3. Now here they are asking, what is the chromatic number or what is the number of colors required to color a graph if the total number of nodes are n? So if the number of nodes are n, then for odd number graph you need odd number of colors as 3. For even number graph you need number of colors as 2. So obviously A, B and C cannot be an answer, but again let us check with option number D. So for this case it is 3 minus 2 into floor value of 3 divided by 2 plus 2, which is again equal to 3 minus 2 into, and this floor value 1.5 floor value is 1 plus 2, which is again 3 minus 2 plus 2, which is equal to 3. So you need 3 colors as a chromatic number, or you can say 3 colors to color this graph. In the same way, if I check out this graph, so here the number of vertices are 4. So just apply this formula. So 4 minus 2 into 4 divided by 2 plus 2, which is equal to 4 minus 2 into 2 plus 2, which is again 2. So you can see the chromatic number of this graph is 2. In the same way, if you look at this graph, so it is 5 minus 2 into 5 divided by 2 plus 2, which is equal to 5 minus 4 plus 2, which is equal to 3. So you can see the chromatic number is matching for this graph also. So if the value of n is even, then you will always get 2 as the answer in option number D. If the value of n is odd, then you will always get 3 as the answer in option number D. Okay. Now let us look at this question. The minimum number of colors required to color the following graph such that no two adjacent vertices are assigned the same color. Okay. And again, this problem is from the chromatic numbers. We have already seen this problem before. So the very simple way of solving this problem is that you can take a color and you can start coloring the vertices. You can pick any color. So let us suppose if I pick a color black. So I can color this initial vertex as black, and then I have to give a different color to all the adjacent vertices. Okay, so I have to give a, let us suppose if I give a color blue to this, then I cannot give a color blue to this vertex. I have to give a separate color, right? Again, I can give a blue color to this again, but again, let me choose one more color. So I can give a, okay, let me try and do this way. So if I give a color which is again blue to this vertex, and if I try and give a color to maroon to this vertex, okay, if I do this way, so I can color this vertex as black, and I can color this adjacent vertices as green, and now I can color this vertex as I cannot color black, green, I have to choose a different color here. So let's suppose this color might be the gray color. So I can give a gray color to this. Okay, so in this way you can check how many colors are there. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So total of 5 colors are required. But again, is there any scenario possible where we need less than 5 colors? Let us see. So if I give a black color to this, then I can give a blue color to this, I can give a maroon color to this, and then I can again give let us suppose I can give a blue color to this, and here I'm giving a green color to this vertex. Okay, now I've used how many colors? I've used 4 colors. Now I can take the black color again. So after taking the black color again, I can give this vertex as green color, and I can give this vertex as maroon color, and then the remaining vertex I can give a black color. Now you can see the total number of colors that I've used to color this graph is 4. So 4 is the correct answer. So for this particular graph, you need a minimum of 4 colors to color all the vertices. Okay, so I hope that you got the answer. Now let us look at the next question here. This is a very, very interesting question, and let us understand the question first. It's a very beautifully framed question. Okay, consider the undirected graph G defined as follows. The vertex of G are bit string of length n. So let us suppose we have bit strings, right? So let us suppose n is equal to 3. So how many bit strings of 3 are there? So we have 0 0 0 0 0 1 0 1 0 0 1 1 1 0 0 1 0 1 1 1 0 and 1 1 1. So there are of 2^3 strings are possible. 2^3 strings are possible in general, which is equal to 2^n, which is equal to 2^n. Now we have an edge between a vertex u and a vertex v if and only if u and v differ by exactly one bit position. That means, for example, if you take this bit and if you take this bit, there's a difference of only one bit. Only one bit is a different, right? But if you take this one and this one, you can see there's a difference of 2 bits. So obviously there cannot be an edge between those bits, right? Now the ratio of chromatic number of graph G to the diameter of G. Okay, so we have to find what is the chromatic number of this graph and what is the diameter of this graph. Now if you look at this graph, so there are two things that will come into your mind. The first thing that will come in my mind is basically a K-map, because in K-map we use cyclic codes, and these cyclic codes are the codes which are differing by one bit only. So this will look some similar to a K-map. Secondly, there's something called as cube, hypercube. So there's a hypercube. Okay, let me show you what is a hypercube. So we can make a hypercube. In a hypercube, we connect those edges which are differing by only one bit. Okay, let us suppose we have hypercube where n is equal to 1. That means you have only one bit. So in that case, this is representing a bit 0 and this is representing a bit 1, and we can connect these two edges. Okay, so this is a hypercube of 1 bit. So if I take 2 bits, so in that case the possible combinations are 0 0 0 1 1 0 and 1 1. So in this case again we have to connect those vertices which are differing by 1 bit only. So here we have a difference of 1 bit, here we have a difference of 1 bit, here we have a difference of 1 bit, and here also we have a difference of 1 bit. We cannot connect 0 0 with 1 1. Why? Because there's a difference of 2 bits. And then if I say n is equal to 3, in that case, what are the possible cases? These are the possible cases. Then I can write it this way. We can have 0, 0, 0 here. Then we can have 0, 0, 1 here. We can have 0, 1, 0 here. And we can have 1, 0, 0 here. Okay. Or instead of taking 1, 0, 0. Okay, I can take 1, 0, 0. And we can also have bits like we have 0, 1, 1. We can have 1, 1, 0. We can have 1, 0, 1. In the same way, we can have 1, 1, 1. So we have to connect those vertices which are differing by 1 bit only. So here, there's a difference of 1 bit, 1 bit, and 1 bit. And here you can see there's a difference of only 1 bit. And here you can see there's a difference of only 1 bit. And here you can see there's a difference of only 1 bit. And here also you can see there's a difference of only 1 bit. And you can see here there's a difference of 1 bit. And here there's a difference of 1 bit. And you can see between them there's a difference of only 1 bit. So we get a graph like this. But if you look at this graph carefully, you can also rearrange this graph in a separate manner. You can also draw the same graph in this manner. Okay, where this vertex is representing 0, 0, 0, this vertex is representing 0, 0, 1, this is 1, 0, 1, this is 1, 0, 0, this is 1, 1, 1, this is 0, 1, 1, this is 1, 1, 0, and this is 0, 1, 0. So this graph and this graph, both are exactly the same. Both these graphs are same. So it is more like I have drawn this graph in a two different manner. Okay. So you can easily see how you can draw it hypercube. Okay. Now we also know that for a hypercube, hypercubes are bipartite. We हमें already पता है कि जो हमारे hypercube हैं ये bipartite है. We have already covered this in the graph theory. So hypercubes are bipartite. That means you need only two colors. You need only two colors to color the hypercube. तो आपको सिर्फ दो colors की requirement है. Okay, and what is the diameter of hypercube? So when you look at a hypercube, the diameter of hypercube is n itself. Okay, so for example, for any vertex, maybe if I take this vertex or if I take this vertex, if I take any two vertices, what is the diameter? So you can take a diameter, you can go to this path 1, 2, and 3. You can go to any path, you need 3 edges for this. Okay, now if you take this and this, so you need only 2 edges to go to this path, right? So if you take any 2 edges, so diameter is n itself. So they are asking what is the ratio of chromatic number of the graph and the diameter. So the ratio is going to be 2 divided by n. Why? Because these hypercubes are bipartite and this maximum distance or the diameter here is n. Okay, so diameter is basically a maximum eccentricity. So I think you already know the diameter. We have already covered the diameters in previous video. So correct answer is option number C for this given question. Now let us look at this question. In this question, they are asking that what is the chromatic number of the following graph? So what is the chromatic number? Is what is the minimum number of colors required to color all the vertices of the graph? So I can take two different colors. So let us suppose I take a color red. I can color this vertex as red, and I have to give a different color to its adjacent vertices. So let us suppose I give a color yellow to this, I can give a color yellow to this, and again I can give a same red color to the other vertices which are not adjacent. I can give a red color here, I can give a red color here, as well as I can give a red color here, and then I can use a yellow color in these cases. And then you can clearly see that this last vertex here, I cannot give a red color because it is connected using this edge. So because of that, I have to use a different color here. So you can see the chromatic number of this graph is going to be 3. So you need minimum of 3 colors to color all the edges of this graph. So it is 3. Okay. Now this question is again very interesting question. They are saying, what is the chromatic number of an n vertex simple connected graph which does not contain any odd length cycle? So we need a graph which does not have odd length cycle, right? So, and they are saying the n is greater than 2. So we can say number of vertices can be 3, number of vertices can be 4, number of vertices can be 5, number of vertices can be 6, number of vertices can be 7, and so on. So if you have 3 vertices, so this is a simple connected graph with 3 vertices, but you can see the cycle in this graph is an odd length cycle. It is a odd length cycle, right? So obviously I cannot choose this graph. So again, this is one more graph, and here the cycle is an even length cycle. This is an even length cycle. See, first of all, you should know what is a simple connected graph. Simple connected graph means a graph which is not containing a self loop and which is also not containing parallel edges, right? So even if I try and draw a graph here, like this, so this is also a simple graph, but the problem is here we got a cycle which is an odd length cycle, right? Or even if I try and draw a complete graph like this, so here in this case you have odd length cycle. So you have, this is an odd length cycle, this is an odd length cycle, this is an odd length cycle, and this is an odd length cycle. So I cannot have a graph here which is having an odd length cycle. So only this graph is acceptable. These two graphs are not acceptable, even though these two graphs are simple graphs, but they are not acceptable for this given question. So if I have number of edges as 5, so obviously there will be an odd length cycle here if you make it connected and simple graph. So this will be odd length cycle, so I'm going to reject it, right? But if I make a graph like this, so you can see here we have an even length cycle, okay, even length cycle, and this graph is also connected, right? In the same way, you can also connect it in many other fashions, many other ways. And if you have 6 vertices, you can have this graph. So here it is having even cycle, or you can have this graph. So again, here it is having 6 vertices and it is also having even length cycle. And they're asking, what is the chromatic number for these graphs? In graphically, chromatic number kya hoga? So you can see for this graph, the chromatic number is 2. So you need only 2 colors to color the vertices of this graph, right? For this graph also the chromatic number is 2, so you can give a color to this vertex, or let us try and give a color. So I can give maroon color to this, I can give a maroon color to this, I can give a maroon color to this, and I can give a maroon color to these vertices, right? And then for this graph also, this is a even length cycle, so I need 2 colors only. This is exactly the theorem that we have covered. The very first question, if you remember it, you know that if your graph is having an even length cycle, for even length cycle, the chromatic number is always 2. Okay, so here you need only 2 colors to color this graph. Chromatic number is always 2 if you have an even length cycle. If you have an odd length cycle, then the chromatic number is going to be 3. Okay, so even if you look at this one, so here you can give a chromatic number which is 2. I can give a maroon color to this, and then I can give a blue color to this, right? I can give a blue color to this, I can give a blue color to this, and then I can also give a maroon color to this, right? So in this way you can see the chromatic number is always 2. So there are two ways. Either you can prove this in the exam, so you can prove using various theorems, you can reason using various theorems, or you can make diagrams like this and then you can try and see what is the chromatic number that you are getting. The problem is when you try and prove this in the examination, it is going to be very difficult and it is going to be very time consuming. Very difficult and time consuming during the examination. But if you create the graphs like this, maybe after 2 or 3 minutes, you will be getting the answer very easily. So the answer for this problem is very simple. The answer is 2. Option number A is the correct answer for this given problem. I hope that you understood the problem, and if you have any doubt, you can ask me. But what I've done is, how I solve this problem, I've taken trials, I've taken a few examples, and then I try to identify if I can get a graph like this, right? So the correct answer is option number A, which is 2. Next, the number of colors that is sufficient to vertex color any planar graph. So aapko pata hai, if we have already discussed in our videos, so here they are asking the minimum number of colors, but any planar graph. So there are two problems. First student will see, sir, this is also a planar graph which is having only vertex one, right? And for this graph only one color is required. But you can see they are asking about any planar, koi bhi planar graph hona chahiye. What is the minimum number of color required for that planar graph? And this is exactly a direct theorem from your Kenneth H. Rawson book. The correct answer is 4. Direct theorem from the book. It is not a special difficult question. Now here they are asking, what is the chromatic number of the following graph? Again, very simple question. What you have to do is, you have to take colors and you have to start coloring these vertices. Okay, so I can take one color. Let us suppose I take a maroon color, and then I'll try and color this first vertex as red. I can color this vertex as red, and I have to color all the adjacent vertices at some other color. So I'm going to color this as blue, and so let us suppose I am going to color this as blue. Okay, So see, again there's a trick here, because if you try to color this blue, you cannot do it. You cannot color the vertex C as blue, because this is adjacent to both the blue colors. So I have to choose a separate color, let us suppose, which is green. So this is a green color. Then again I have to choose a maroon color for D. So this D is maroon. And then now for this vertex F, again I can choose a green color. So vertex F ke liye bhi main dobara se green color ko choose kar sakta hun. Right, so you can see what is the number of colored required. So the number of colored required in this case is 3. So correct answer for this problem is 3. Right, so I hope that you got it. If you have any doubt, you can ask it. So the chromatic number for this graph is 3. So the question is, the maximum possible edges in an undirected graph with n vertices and k components. So these kind of questions we have also done before. When can we have that? When can we have a maximum possible edges in an undirected graph with k components? Is that if one set is connected and all the other sets are disconnected? Let me show you with the help of example. So let us suppose that we have number of edges, the vertices are 5, and number of components is equal to 1. So we'll figure out the solutions one by one. Okay. So in this case, you can have total of 5 edges. Right, so here the maximum number of edges in this case will be, what is the maximum number of edges? So that is going to be 10, because it is a complete graph with 5 vertices. So number of edges are going to be 10. Okay, but what if we have 2 components? Then we say the complete graph with 5 vertices and number of components are equal to 2. Now there are many scenarios are possible. What are the scenarios that are possible? We can have one scenario where we have 4 vertices, which all these 4 vertices are connected to each other, and this is a complete graph, and there's one vertex which is not connected. Okay, so this is one possible case where number of components are 2 and number of vertices are 5, therefore the number of edges will be 6. So what can be a second scenario? A second scenario can be something like this, that we have two complete graphs here. So in the first graph we have 3 vertices, in the second graph we have 2 vertices. So in this case, again the number of components are 2, but number of edges are 4. What can be the third case? So we can have a third case where we can have the number of components are 2. I guess this is the only possible 2 cases, right? So these are the only 2 possible 2 cases in this case. But what if we say that this n is equal to 5 and number of components are 3. So what is that possible cases? So what is the first case? The first case that is possible is that 3 components are there. So that is, one vertex is here, one vertex is here, these 2 vertices are not connected with each other, and these 3 vertices are basically connected with each other, right? So here number of edges will be equal to 3. Okay, so what can be a second case? We can have a second case here where we have 2 vertices here which are connected, 2 vertices here which are connected, and this is one vertex. So here the number of edges is equal to 2, right? So this is, again, you can clearly see here we are having a maximum number of edge, here we are having a maximum number of edge. So in any case, if I say that we have total of n vertices, if I say we have total of n vertices and we have k edges, in any of these we have k components, not edges, this is k components. So in any of these cases, what will happen is we have all these k minus 1 edges, so all these k minus 1 vertices which are not connected with each other, and all the other remaining vertices. So how many vertices will be remaining out of these total n? Or I can draw the diagram in a much better way. Let me just draw the diagram. So this is the complete graph. So we can have total of k minus 1 vertices. So these all are basically k minus 1 vertices which are not connected with anyone. These are k minus 1 vertices, and the last, all these vertices which are remaining, all the vertices which are remaining here. So how many vertices are remaining? So these vertices that will be remaining, they will be n minus k. So this is n minus k vertices are remaining. Okay, so n minus k plus 1, I should say, because they k minus 1 vertices are there, so it is n minus k vertices are remaining. Now if I can make a complete graph, if I can make it a complete graph, then I can get the maximum number of edges. So what is the what will be the number of edges in a complete graph with these many vertices? So the number of edges will be n minus k plus 1 c2. This is something that we have already seen in our classes, and so in a complete graph, with n vertices, we have total of n c2 edges, which is also equal to n into n minus 1 divided by 2. So in the same way, here we have n minus k plus 1 vertices, so this value, these many edges will be there, right? So you can calculate this value, and that will be the solution for this given problem. So I hope that you understood this problem. Now let us look at the next problem. Now this is again a very, very interesting problem. Here what they are trying to say is, consider a simple connected graph G with n vertices and n edges. So number of edges and number of vertices are greater than 2. Which of the following statements are true? See, the first statement is G has no cycle. The second statement is, graph obtained by removing any edge from G is connected. G has at least one cycle. The graph obtained by removing any two edges makes the graph connected. See, whenever we have a graph, so in a graph, if the graph is connected, in that case, the minimum number of edges, will be number of vertices minus 1. Okay, so if I say there are total of n vertices, in that case, the minimum number of edges will be n minus 1. Okay, and the maximum number of edge that the graph will be having is n into n minus 1 divided by 2, which is also equal to nc2. So this will be a complete graph. And here, this will be representing a tree. Okay, so tree which is having no cycles, and this graph is a connected graph. Now they are saying that we have n vertices as well as we have total of n edges. Instead of n minus 1, we have a total of n edges. So obviously, if we have n edges and n vertices and it is a connected graph, that means there will be at least, there will be one cycle. Not at least, there will be one cycle in the graph. Okay, so if you remove one edge, again the graph will not get disconnected. Graph jo hai wo disconnected nahi hoga. Okay, so graph will still be connected, fine. So but if you remove two edges from here, if you remove two edges, in that case the number of edges will become n minus 2. So that means the graph will become disconnected, because in a connected graph the minimum edges should be n minus 1, but here the edges will become n minus 2. Okay, so they're asking which of the following statement is true. The first, graph has no cycle. This is false, because obviously if there are n edges, obviously the graph should be having cycle, right? If the number of edges are n minus 1, the graph will not be having any cycle. Option number 2, the graph obtained by removing any edge from G is not connected. This is also false, because in that case the graph can become a tree. So it is not always the case. Sometimes the graph might get disconnected, but again the graph can become a tree. Then graph has at least one cycle. This is true. So I should say it is not one, it should be at least one. So there can be at least one cycle in the graph. And then option number D, the graph obtained by removing any two edges from the graph G is not connected. This is also true, because if you remove two edges, so there will be total of n minus two edges, and again it will not form a tree. So option number C and option number D both are true for this given question. Now let us look at the next question. The number of edges in a regular graph of degree D and n vertices. अगर आपके पास एक regular graph है जिसके अंदर degree D है और total n vertices हैं, तो उसके अंदर कितनी edges होंगी? See, when I say a regular graph means the degree of every vertex is same. The degree of every vertex is same in a regular graph, right? And we know there's a degree theorem. I mean, so that is, we know that every edge contributes 2 in the degree, right? So that means if you do something like this, 2 into number of edges in the graph, so that will be equal to degree of all the vertices in the graph. So degree of all the vertices in the graph. So all the vertex 0 to vertex n, all the vertices in the graph, right? So here we can find out this sum very easily. So this sum will be d into n. So this is 2 into number of edges will be equal to d multiplied by n. Therefore, the number of edges will be equal to d multiplied by n divided by 2. It is a very simple question and you can easily solve it by the same basic theorems. So let us look at the next question here. They are saying the minimum number of edges in a connected cyclic graph with n vertices. So total you have n vertices, right? So this is number of vertex, if this is equal to 4. So vertex number 1, vertex number 2, vertex number 3 and vertex number 4. And it is a cyclic graph and they are asking minimum number of edges. We cannot have n minus 1 edges because that will make it a tree. So the minimum number of edges in this case is going to be 4. Right? If the number of edges is equal to 3, which is equal to n minus 1, then it will make it as a tree. So in any connected cyclic graph with n vertices, there will be a total of minimum of n cycles. I mean, there will be minimum of n edges. And what is the maximum number of edges? So maximum number of edges will be n into n minus 1 divided by 2. So this is the maximum number of cycles, this is the maximum number of edges, and this is the minimum number of edges, which is n in a connected cyclic graph. Okay, very simple and straightforward question. Let us look at this question. The number of articulation points for the given graph. Look, what is articulation point? Articulation point is that if you remove that point from the graph, then the graph will become disconnected. Okay. So let me show you, let me draw the graph once again here. So this is the vertices. This is your graph, right? So if you remove any vertex from the graph, then if that makes it a disconnected graph, then we can say that is an articulation point, right? So for example, if I remove the vertex number 2, so if I remove the vertex number 2, then this vertex number 4 will not be connected with anyone. So you can see in that case, the graph will become disconnected. So that vertex number 2 is an articulation point. Okay. In the same way, let us suppose if I remove the vertex number 3, if I just remove the vertex number 3, so after removing the vertex number 3, again, you can see the graph will become disconnected. So there will be two components in the graph. In the same way, if I remove the vertex number 5, if I just remove this vertex number 5, again you can see the graph will become disconnected because when I remove the vertex number 5, then I also have to remove this edge. So again, the number of components will become 3. So basically, there are 3 articulation points here. The first articulation point is 2, the second articulation point is 3, and the third articulation point is 5. If you remove these vertices or any one of these vertices, then the graph will become disconnected. So correct answer for this problem is D, which is 3. So the maximum number of edges in an n node undirected graph without self loop. So I believe we have already solved this question many times so far. So it is nc2, or you can say n into n minus 1 divided by 2. From both of them you will get the same value. So correct answer is option number B. Very straightforward and direct question. There's no, you don't have to spend a lot of time on this question. This is a very time saving question. Okay, now let us look at this question. It's also a very interesting question here. Let G be an arbitrary graph with n nodes and k components. If a vertex is removed from G, then the number of components in the resultant graph must necessarily lie down between. So you have a total of n nodes and k components, right? So these k components can be drawn in any way, any fashion, right? So what you can do is, so let me make an example here. Let me take an example. I can suppose we have this graph. So it is a star graph and here the number of components are 2. We also have this graph, which is having a complete graph here, and this is also a complete graph, right? So this is again here the number of components are 2. Here the number of components are 2. And we can also have this graph where these are the vertices and there are total of, let us suppose, n vertices and there are total of n components, right? So because none of these vertices is connected, Now they're asking, there are n nodes and k components. So in this last case, we have n is equal to k. Here in this case, the number of vertices are going to be 7 and the number of components are 2. And in this case, the number of vertices are going to be 3, 3, 6, 7 and number of components are again 2. Now, if a vertex is removed from G, the number of components in the resulted graph must lie down between which of the following. If you remove one vertex, then how many number of components can be there? So if you look at the very first graph, if I remove this vertex, if I just move number this vertex, then the number of vertices will become 6 and number of components will also become 6, right? In that case, the number of components will become n minus 1, right? So this is the case which is possible, right? And if I take this graph, now in this graph, if I remove one vertex, again the number of components will become here n minus 1. Right, so in both these cases, so here the number of components again here will it will become n minus 1, and here also if I remove one vertex, then again the number of components will become n minus 1. But what if we have a graph in such a way that it is a complete graph? Fine, so that means this is here in this graph we have two complete graph. Now if I take down any vertex here whatsoever, you can take any one vertex here, and still the number of components will become 2. Number of components are still 2, right? So in this case, the number of components are not getting decreased. The number of components are exactly the same, okay? So let us suppose if we have this graph which is having a total of 5 vertices, right? And this is completely connected, and so number of vertices are 5 and number of components are 2. Now in this case, if I remove this vertex, so the number of components will become 1, right? So what will happen in any case, if we have a graph where we have two components, where the first component is a complete connected graph and second component is an isolated vertex, in that case number of components will decrease by 1. And in any graph where none of these components or none of these vertices are connected, in that case if I remove one vertex, so number of components will become n minus 1, right? So that means the correct answer will be option number C, that number of components will be between these two values. Okay, so correct answer will be option number C. I hope that you understood this, but if you could not understand, let me also try to explain the same question again. Okay, so we have two boundary cases here, right? So what are the boundary case? I'm explaining the same question again, but in a simpler language. So in the first boundary case, we have a total of n vertices. We have total of n vertices and number of components are also n. In the second case, we have total of n vertices, right? There are n vertices and number of components are equal to 2. Now in the first case, if you remove one vertex, then the number of components will become n minus 1. In the second case, if you remove one vertex, the number of components will become 1, which is equal to k minus 1. So what can happen here is that whenever we have n nodes and k components, in that case, if you remove one vertex, then the number of components in minimum will be k minus 1 and in maximum will be n minus 1. So that is why option number C is a correct answer for this problem. Now let us look at this question. What is the number of vertices in an undirected connected graph with 27 edges, 6 vertices of degree 2, 3 vertices of degree 4 and remaining of degree 3? Okay, let us solve this question. So they are having total of 27 edges. So we know the sum of the degree theorem. So we know 2 into number of edges. Let me just write it. 2 into number of edges will be equal to degree of every vertex multiplied by number of vertices, or you can say you can also modify this formula: 2 into number of edges is equal to summation degree of all the vertices, degree of all the vertices from vertex number 1 to n, right? So this is the formula that we know. So here we know that the total number of edges are 27. So it is 2 into 27 is equal to 6 vertices of degree 2 plus 3 vertices of degree 4 plus there are x vertices of degree 3. Now this will be 54 is equal to 12 plus 3x, and this value is going to be how much? This is going to be 30 is equal to 3x, therefore x is equal to 10. So you can see there are total of 10 vertices of degree 3. Now they're asking what's the number of vertices. So number of vertices will be 6 plus 3 plus 10, which is equal to total of 19 vertices. So correct answer will be option number D, where we are going to get total of 19 vertices in this case. Now, what is the maximum number of edges in an acyclic untitled graph with n vertices? So because they are saying it is a acyclic graph and it is also undirected graph, that means it is a tree. Now for a tree with n vertices, there are total of n minus 1 edges. We already know this. It is a very straightforward question which will save a lot of your time in examination. So correct answer is option number A. Okay, so let us look at this question. They are saying let G be a simple graph with 20 vertices and 100 edges. The size of minimum vertex cover of G, so this is minimum vertex cover of G is 8, and the size of maximum independent set is, what is the maximum independence set? So first of all, you should know what is a vertex cover. You should know what is a vertex cover. You should know what is an edge cover. Then you should know what is a independence set or independent set, and you should know what is an independent number. Okay, independent number or independence number, both of the things are same, right? Now in this case we only need the vertex cover and we only need the independent set. So I'm going to explain what is the independence set and vertex cover, and these two things I'm not going to explain because I've already covered them in my classes or examples. So let me show you what exactly is a vertex cover. So if we have a graph like this, I'm just drawing any random graph with any vertices like this. So this is just a random graph. Okay, this is vertex 1, vertex 2, vertex 3, vertex 4 and vertex 5. Vertex cover means what is the minimum number of vertices are required so that every edge can be covered. Let me show you. If I take the vertex 1, in that case this edge is covered. Okay, or if I take the vertex 2, in that case I will be able to cover this edge, I will be able to cover this edge, as well as I will be able to cover this edge. In the same way, if I take the vertex 4, then I will be able to cover this edge and I will be able to cover this edge. Now if I take the vertex 5, then I will be able to cover this edge, I will be able to cover this edge, and I will be able to cover this edge. So you can see every edge is covered. So the vertex cover is 2, 4 and 5. See, whenever I take a vertex, the edges which are incident on that vertex, they are covered. So just by taking these three vertices, each and every edge of this graph, every edge of this graph can be covered. Okay, and what is an independence set? So independence set is about the vertices which are not adjacent with each other. Okay, so let me show you. If I take the vertex 1 and vertex 3, so vertex 1 and 3, they are not adjacent with each other. In the same way, vertex 1 and 5, they are not adjacent because they do not have any edge between them. So vertex 1, vertex 3, vertex 5, right? So these vertices are the vertices which are independent, okay, which are creating an independence set. In the same way, we can have more than one different independence set also. I can have the vertex 2 and vertex 4 in an independence set, and make it, this is the vertex 6 maybe. So I think I should name these vertices. Actually, this is the vertex 6, so I should write it 6 here, right? So in this case, if I take the vertex 2, if I take the vertex 4, if I take the vertex 5, so that is creating an independence set. Vertex 1, vertex 3 and vertex 5 is creating an independence set. So in the same way, we can have more than one independence set in any graph. Now they have already given it the size of minimum vertex cover is 8, and they're asking what is maximum size of independence set. So it is very simple. If you have a total of 20 vertices, now if I subtract this minimum vertex cover, so this will give us maximum independent set. This will give us maximum independent set. So this value will be 12. So this might not be true for every graph, right? So for some graph this might be true, but again the size of maximum independent set here is going to be 12. So the correct answer will be option number A. Okay, so option number A will be a correct answer for this given problem. Now let us look at this question. Again, this question is very, very interesting because there are many people who will find that this question is difficult. But again, this is not such a difficult question. It's a very interesting and easy question. So first, let us try and understand the question, and then maybe you can figure out what I'm trying to say. So what they are saying is that we have the vertices between 1 to 100. So we have vertices like 1, 2, 3, 4, up to so on, 10. Then again, we have vertex 11, 12, 13, 14, up to so on, 20. Up to so on, we have vertices like 91, 90, 91, up to so on, like 100. These are the vertices in the graph. Now, there will be a vertex, there will be edge from vertex j to I if j is equal to I plus 1. So that means if I take vertex 2, so vertex 2 will be connected to vertex 3. Vertex 3 will be connected to vertex 2. Vertex 4 will be connected to vertex 3. Why? Because this is representing your j and this is representing your I, right? So if I do I plus 1, then that will be equal to j. Okay, again here this is representing j, this is representing I. So then you can see how these vertices are connected, and then every vertex is also connected with 3i. So that means this will be connected to the vertex number which is 3. This will be connected to vertex number which is 9. So this will be connected to vertex number which is 27. That will be connected to some vertex number which is up to so on, right? So that will, might be connected to vertex number maybe something, some vertex is there, right? So now they're asking, what is the minimum number of edges in the path from this first vertex to the 100 vertex? You want to go from this vertex to this vertex, then what is the minimum number of edges that you can encounter in the path? Okay, so what you can do is you can take a path this way. From vertex 1 you can go to vertex 3 because this is j and this is 3i, right? Okay, I mean this is j and this is I. So you can, from vertex 1 you can go to vertex 3, from vertex 3 you can go to vertex 9, from vertex 9 you can go to vertex 27, and from vertex 27, you can go to some vertex, maybe 27 into 3, which is going to be 1, 2, this is 81. You can go to vertex 81, and from vertex 81, you can go to vertex 82, you can go to vertex 83, up to so on, you reach the vertex 100. So again, you can see that path will become very, very lengthy. But again, is there any path which is better than this? Kya aisa koi path possible hai jo isse better hai? Yes, there's a path. I can go from vertex 1 to 3, from 3 to 9 to I can go to 30. Sorry, from vertex 9 I can go to vertex number 10, and from vertex 10 I can go to vertex 11, from vertex 11 I can go to vertex 33, from 33 I can go to 99, and from 99 I can go to 100. So this is just an intuitive question, so you just have to do hit and trial, there's no other way. And if you see, the number of edges between them is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7, so there are total of 7 edges. So minimum number of edges that are required from vertex 1 to 100 is going to be 7. So this question is actually more like an aptitude question. So first of all, you should know how to draw this graph, and then you should know how to trace the path from vertex 1 to 100. It is not such a question that you need mathematical proofs and you need so much in-depth knowledge. This is just a graph which is having basic aptitude skills. Okay. Now let us look at this question. 2 raised power n vertices of a graph corresponds to all the subset of a size of set n. For n greater than or equal to 6, 2 vertices of G are adjacent if and only if the corresponding set intersects in exactly 2 elements. I think this is a question that we have already done so far. Let me again tell you this question I have done 2 times, this kind of question. But again, let me tell you, let us suppose that we have a set A which is having 3 elements. So what are the subsets of A? Subsets of A will be 5, 1, 2, 3, and then we can have 1, 2, then we can have 2, 3, then we can have 3, 1, then we can have 1, 2, 3. Now you can see that these vertices will be having any n edge between them, but these vertices are going to be isolated because they'll not be having any edge between them because the cardinality itself is 1. So how can they have 2 elements in common? So you can see these vertices will create a one connected component, and these vertices will create n plus 1 connected components. So number of connected components will be n plus 1 plus 1, which is equal to n plus 2. So there will be a total of n plus 2 connected components. So correct answer will be option number B. Now let us look at this question. They are saying, if all the edge weights of an undirected graph are positive, then any subset of edge that connects all the vertices and has minimum total weight is which of the following? Okay, so see, we know that we have an undirected graph, okay, are positive. So we have an undirected graph like this. This is an undirected graph, vertex A, B, C and D. The weight of every edge is 1, right? And any subset of edge that connects all the vertices has a minimum total weight is, if I take any subset of edge, right, which connects all the vertices, I can take a subset like vertex A, vertex D and vertex B. So if I take these three vertices, so this subset will become something like this, right? So this subset here, it is becoming a tree, right? So the correct answer is tree, right? So it is not going to create a hypercube, it is not going to create a grid or Hamiltonian cycle. So if I take any undirected graph whatsoever, so even if I take this graph, this kind of graph, right? What is this graph? This graph is an hypercube. Even if I take a hypercube and if I take any subset, so this word is very important, that any subset of the edges. So this is edge E1, this is the edge E2, this is the edge E1, this is the edge E2, this is the edge E3 and so on. So if I take any subset, so let us suppose if I take a subset as edge E2 only one edge is there. So again, because of that edge, this is becoming a tree. It is not going to become a hypercube. Or if I take two edges, so for let us suppose if I take edge E1 and E2, so E1 and E2, again, it is going to create a tree. It is not going to create a hypercube. So correct answer for this problem is option number D, which is a tree. Now, which of the following graph has a Eulerian circuit? So if you remember what is a Eulerian circuit, in a Eulerian graph, the degree of every vertex should be even, or there should be exactly two vertices of odd degree. Okay. So we have something called as Eulerian path, Eulerian circuit, and we have something called as Eulerian path. So किसी भी ग्राफ के अंदर यूलेरियन सर्किट कब एग्जिस्ट करेगा? When does the Eulerian circuit exist in a graph? If degree of every vertex in the graph is even and the graph should be connected. And when does the Eulerian path exist? If there are exactly two vertices of odd degree in the graph and the graph is connected, then we can say there exists a Eulerian path. Now we remember these two theorems, these two things that we have already covered. Now just apply them. In the first, any k regular graph where k is an even number. So k regular graph means the degree of every vertex is same. So even if I take this graph, which is having two components like this, so here in this graph the degree of every vertex is 2 and it is a 2 regular graph, right? So when I take a regular graph, it does not mean the graph is connected. So obviously this cannot be an answer. Option number 2, a complete graph with 90 vertices. So if you have a complete graph with 90 vertices, in that case the degree of every vertex is 89. So again, which is an odd number, so it cannot be having a error circuit. Then the complement of a cycle of 25 vertices. So if I take a cycle of 25 vertices, in that case, so if I take the complement, again that will not be a okay. So the complement of cycle of 25 vertices, so how do you take a complement of a graph? So complement of a graph is take the complete graph with 25 vertices and subtract this graph. So for a complement of a graph with n vertices, you have to take a complete graph with n vertices and then you have to subtract that graph from that complete graph. Now here's the complement of a cycle of 25 vertices. So we have a total of 25 vertices in a graph like this, right? So here in this graph, the degree of every vertex will be 2. And in a complete graph with 25 vertices, the degree of every vertex will be 24, right? So in that case, again, in a complete graph with 25 vertices, the degree of every vertex is 24. And if I subtract this cycle with 25 vertices, again, that will give us the degree of every vertex is going to be 22, right? So because the degree of every vertex is even here in this case, so because the degree of every vertex is even, so obviously there will exist a Eulerian circuit. So correct answer is option number C for this problem. Option number C jo hai is problem ke liye correct answer rahega. Then G is a simple undirected graph. Some vertices of G are odd degree. Add an odd V to G, make it adjacent to each other vertex of degree G. The resultant graph is for sure which of the following? See, for example, this is a graph, right? And this is a graph. So they are saying the degree of some vertices are odd, okay? And the graph is also like this is here. You can see the degree of all these vertices are odd, right? So some vertices of G are of odd degree. Then add a node V to G and make it adjacent to each other node of the graph. So if I take one more node and I make it adjacent to each vertex like this, so now you can see the degree of every vertex will become even. The degree of every vertex will become even. So because the degree of every vertex will become even, therefore this will become a Euler graph. Okay. Next, consider undirected graph G where the self loops are not allowed. The vertex set of G is as follows: that we have total of 12 vertices horizontally. So we have vertices like this. This is a vertex which is 1, 1. This is a vertex which is 1, 2. This is a vertex which is 1, 3. This is a vertex which is 1, 4. Up to so on. This is a vertex which is 1, 12. Then again, this is a vertex which is 2, 1. Second vertex 2, 2. Third vertex 2, 3. Fourth vertex 2, 4. Up to so on. It is 2, 12. In the same way, we can have the last vertex which is 12, 1. Then we can have 12, 2. Then we can have 12, 3. Up to so on. Last vertex is 12, 12. So these are the vertices. So how many number of vertices are there? So there will be a total of 12 into 12, which is 144 vertices. There will be a total of 144 vertices. Now they're asking, there's an edge between vertex A, B and C, D if A minus C is less than 1, right? So for example, if I take the vertex 1, 1 and we have a vertex 1, 2. So here this is A, B and this is C, D. So if I do A minus C, and this value should be less than or equal to 1. So 1 minus 1 is basically 0. So obviously this condition is satisfied. So that means we'll be having an edge between them. Again, we'll be having an edge between them. Again, we'll be having an edge between them, like so on. In the same way, we'll be having an edge between these vertices also, like, right? So you can have an edge. So you can see it is more like a chessboard. It is becoming more like a chessboard, okay? This way you can have edges between these vertices. Okay, now, and if I do B minus D is less than or equal to 1, right? So B minus D, what do you mean by B minus D? If I take this vertex which is 1, 1, if I take this vertex which is 2, 2, so this is AB and this is CD. Now if I do B minus D here, so which is going to be 1 minus 2, which the value is going to be minus 1, and this minus 1 is less than 1. So again, you can see there will be an edge between them. Again, this way diagonally also there will be edges. Diagonally also there will be edges in this way also. Okay, so they are already specifying these properties. So you can just, I've done this question, so I know. So there will be diagonal edges also. Okay, so there will be edges with every vertex which is horizontally, there will be edges vertically, there will be edges diagonally. Now they're asking the number of edges in the graph is how many edges will be there in this particular graph. This is what they are asking. A very interesting question, as you can see. First of all, you should understand, you should make the graph, you should be able to see how does this graph look like. And once you know how does this graph look like, then you will be able to calculate the number of edges. Now let us calculate the number of edges in one horizontal. So here in one horizontal, there will be total of 11 edges. There are total of 12 vertices. There are 12 vertices and there are 11 edges. In the same way, if I take vertically also, in vertically, there are total of 11 edges and 12 vertices, right? If I just count horizontally and vertically, so horizontally and vertically and vertically, how many edges will be there? So which is equal to how many horizontal lines are there? So there are total of 12 horizontal lines, right? Or you can say 12 rows. In the same way, there are total of 12 columns. There are total of 12 columns, right? So it is going to be 12 into 11 plus 12 into 11. Okay, so one is for horizontal. This is number of edges in horizontally. And this is the number of edges which are vertically. So if you add both of them, so it is going to be 132 plus 132, which is equal to 264. Okay, now we have to count what is the number of edges diagonally. Okay, If you want to count number of edges diagonally, in that case, you can see in each of these boxes, you have two edges, one and two. In each of these boxes, you have two edges. So first of all, you should know how many number of boxes are there. And then you can multiply that number by two. So this is how you can solve this problem. So how can you calculate what is the number of boxes that you have? So the number of boxes that you can have in this case is going to be approximately 11 into 11, which is equal to 121. And then in every box, in each of these box, there are two edges. So just multiply it by two. So it is 242. So you have to add these three numbers, which is 264 plus 242, which is equal to 506. So total there will be 506 edges in this graph. Okay. Total there will be 506 edges. This question is slightly difficult, so I have to explain you again. Dekho, what happens is, if you just check out these conditions, agar aap in sabhi conditions ko check karenge, then you can see that these conditions are going to create a graph like this. These conditions are going to create a graph like this, this way. Because of these conditions, we'll be having a graph like this. Yeah, you have to read these conditions again, right? So you can see in each of these boxes there will be two edges, right? So we will be having a graph like this, right? So here this is representing 1, 1, this is representing 1, 2, this is representing 2, 1, this is representing 2, 2. So these are the vertices. Now in this graph you have to count what is the number of edges. This is what you have to do. So take your time. This problem is difficult, I understand, but you have to solve this problem. You have to take your time, understand this problem, spend some time on this problem, and still if you find it difficult, let me know, I will explain it again. Okay. Next, what is the minimum maximum number of edges in a bipartite graph with 12 vertices? So we can have a bipartite graph which is 6, 6, right? So which is a complete bipartite graph, and the total number of vertices will be 6 plus 6, which is equal to 12. That means on the first set we have 6 vertex, on the second set again we have 6 vertex. So in a complete bipartite graph of 6, 6, so there will be total of 36 edges. So correct answer is 36. It's a question that is going to save a lot of time for you in the examination. Very easy and straightforward questions in this case. Okay. Next question. If G is the forest with N vertices and K components, how many edges does G have? So forest is the collection of trees. Okay. So let me show you with the help of example. So this is a tree. Again, this is graph is representing a forest, right? This graph is representing a forest because this is a tree 1, this is a tree 2, this is a tree 3, and the total of components are 3 in this graph. So collection of many trees is called as a forest. Now in this graph you can see that how many vertices are there. So number of vertices are 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. So in this graph number of vertices are 9 and number of components are 3. Okay, so we know what is the number of vertices, we know number of components. Now they are saying how many edges does the graph is having. So how many edges are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So the total of number of edges are 6. Now just calculate this value, just compare with all these options, you will see it is n minus k. So if you feel that there are more than one options are matching, then what you can do is try and create another graph. Create two, three different graphs and try and see which of these options is matching. So correct answer here is option number C. And this question is again very, very straightforward. All you have to do is make a graph and get the answer. Next, in a connected graph, a bridge is an edge whose removal disconnects the graph. Which of the following statement is true? A tree has no bridge. This is actually false because in tree, every edge is a bridge, right? So every edge makes the tree disconnect, right? A bridge cannot be a part of a simple cycle. This is actually true because bridge cannot be there in a single cycle. Every edge of a clique of size greater than 3 is a bridge. So this is false. And the graph with bridge cannot have a cycle. This is also false. So correct answer is option number B. Right, so this is also very straightforward, right? So you can see that even if this is a graph, now this graph is having a bridge, right? So this is your bridge, and again this graph is having two cycles. So again D is false. Correct answer is option number B. Next question is, let G be an undirected complete graph with N vertices where number of vertices are greater than 2. So this is an undirected complete graph with 3 vertices. Now, the number of different Hamiltonian cycles in G is equal to which of the following? How many Hamiltonian cycles are there? Now, for a Hamiltonian cycle, so first of all, you should know what is a Hamiltonian cycle. So you have to start from a vertex and then you have to come back to the same vertex, right? And you cannot visit one vertex more than once. So this is a complete graph with 3 vertices, this is a complete graph with 4 vertices. In the same way, we can have a complete graph with 5 vertices. Now, in the complete graph with 3 vertices, there is only one Hamiltonian cycle. In complete graph with 4 vertices, there are many Hamiltonian cycles. That is, we can go from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, and 4 to 1. We can go from 1 to 3, 3 to 2, 2 to 4, and 4 to 1. We can go from 1 to 2, 2 to 4, 4 to 3, and 3 to 1. So these 3 cycles are present as of now, right? But again, if you take a reverse of these cycles, like for example, from 1 I can go to 4, 4 to 3, 3 to 2, 3 to 1. So again, this reverse will be equal to the same only. The reverse will be same. And this question also I have already covered in the class. This is a direct question from my classes. So I told you the answer for this problem is option number D, because it is n minus 1 factorial divided by 2. But you can also verify with this case. So here the number of vertices are 4. So it is 4 minus 1 factorial divided by 2, which is equal to 6 divided by 2, which is equal to 3. So you can see for this graph, there are only 3 different Hamiltonian cycles are present. 3 unique Hamiltonian cycles are present for this graph. This question, and you can also verify it here. So it is n minus 1 factorial divided by 2. So it is 3 minus 1 factorial divided by 2, which is equal to 1. Right. So in this graph, there's only one Hamiltonian cycle. In this graph, there are 3 Hamiltonian cycles. So for any graph, you can calculate these values. And this is a question directly from the classroom that I've covered in the classes itself. Okay.